Hello everybody, welcome to the Java course. When a method throws an exception, it is possible that the method doesn't need to handle the exception directly. Instead, the method can tell the calling method to handle the exception. And actually, the calling method does not always need to handle the exception directly. It can tell its own calling method to handle the exception. So this is known as the process of exception propagation. In words, I can explain it as follows. We have a method that throws an exception to the calling method. And the calling method that receives the exception object can let its own calling method handle the exception. That means this process is known as the exception propagation. So in principle, the process is like this. I'm going to use an example to illustrate the idea of exception propagation. Now I'm going to accept an input from the keyboard, so I need to import the scanner class first. Okay, and then I would like to have a variable to store the value input by the user. So the balance variable is of integer data type, and you can see that I'm going to accept a value that represents the balance in the bank account. So I give a prompt first to allow the user to input the bank balance. Here, I would use the next int method to receive the user input. Then I can close the scan object. My idea is to create a method called check balance, which would help me to check whether the value obtained by the user input is too low or too unacceptable. So here I would like to create the implementation of the check balance method. The idea is like this. I don't let the check balance method do the real checking. I will simply create another method to do the real checking. So here I would use a method called doChecking, which will really do the comparison of the balance against some threshold value. Okay, if the amount is less than $500, The doChecking method is going to throw an exception object with this message. Okay. If the balance is okay, I would simply print out the other statement telling that the balance is safe. So in this situation, the doChecking method needs to throw the exception object. Okay. In principle, the calling method of the doChecking method, which is simply the checkBalance method, should handle the exception object thrown by the called method. So now I don't want the checkBalance method to handle the exception directly. Instead, I can tell the calling method of the checkBalance method, which is simply the main method, to handle the exception for me. In this situation, I would like the checkBalance method to throw the exception object back to its own calling method, which is the main method. So I need to let the checkBalance method throw an exception object. Okay, in this situation, the checkBalance method doesn't handle the exception received by the called method doChecking. Now, the exception object will be sent back to the main method. So the main method that calls the checkBalance method needs to handle the exception object. So I need to try the checkBalance method. Okay, it means that the checkBalance method is possible to create an exception object. And then, if the exception happens, we need to have a catch action that really handles the exception. In addition to printing out a warning statement, I also want to print out the stack trace of the exception object. I also want to obtain the message of the exception object. So in this situation, we can take a look at the result of the program. Save it, and then I run it. Okay, I can input a balance value. According to my program, I need to test the condition when the amount is close to $500. So I say $600 for now. I will see that my balance is safe, because in this situation I will simply do the else part of the doChecking method. Let me try to run it again to see another situation. And I input $400. Okay, the exception object will be thrown by the doChecking method, which is received by the checkBalance method. And the checkBalance method doesn't want to handle it directly. It simply throws that object back to its own calling method, which is the main method here. For the main method, it can handle the exception object by printing out the warning statement here. Also, I can print out the stack trace shown in red. Okay. The stack trace simply tells me that the balance is quite low. So this is the message for my given exception object. Also, I can get the message coming from my exception object, which is simply shown here. This is the message that I put to the constructor of my exception class. Okay. So from this example, we can see some important points when we propagate our exception objects. The phrase throws exception cannot be omitted at the end of the check balance method. This is because we really need this phrase to throw the exception object back to the calling method of the check balance method, which is simply the main method in my case. If I forgot to throw the exception back to the main method, the calling method, which is the main method in my case, cannot receive the exception object. If the throws exception phrase is not provided after the method signature of the check balance method, it means that the check balance method needs to handle the exception object received by the called method, which is do checking in my case. So if we really want to do the propagation properly, we have to make sure that the throws exception phrase has to be put at the end of the method signature of the called method of the do checking method here. So this explains the propagation of exception objects in this video. This is the end of the video. If you have any questions about my video, feel free to leave your comments on the comment section below the video. If you like this video, please give me a like and please subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching.